thing.
Right, so I was going to motivate the title. So why machine learning mixed geometry? So in computer vision, in the last few years, like 5-6 years, there has been like an overwhelming shift from axiomatic models to learnable models. So, for instance, there are several companies like Apple, Facebook, or Google adopting this machine learning machinery, in particular neural networks, to solve outstanding problems. So very challenging problems that now reached a breakthrough in accuracy thanks to this deep learning techniques. And the reason why I'm saying machine learning is geometry is that we are not witnessing such breakthroughs in geometry graphics or in computer graphics in general. So today I'm going to see why this is the case, and I'm going to offer some possible solutions to apply machine learning, in particular deep learning, to do some geometry processing or tasks that we usually encounter when we do our geometry processing. All right, so some examples of successful application of deep learning to outstanding problems. So this is this machine called AlphaGo. It was the first machine to beat a human player at the game of Go. So I don't know if you're familiar with the game. It's a very simple set of rules, but like a combinatorial explosion of possibilities. So it's a very tough game. And I mean, modeling a machine that follows certain rules to beat the human player is extremely challenging. So now with the adoption of deep learning, they were able to finally do it. So other applications include autonomous driving. So yeah, driving without hands. And real-time voice translation. I don't know if you tested this. This is already working in Skype. So you have a little hidden button somewhere, so you can talk to your partner and he gets in real-time a translation, or like a spoken translation of what you're saying in his language. So this is working pretty well. And you can imagine, I mean, languages maybe look simple, but it is not easy to model the structure of all languages. So what they do, they're actually using machine learning, artificial intelligence, to do the translation for you. All right, so let's have a look at this brief timeline. So actually, artificial intelligence and neural networks in particular, they are not new at all. So they were introduced like 60 years ago, this model, the perception by Rosenblatt. And then we witnessed something that I'm referring to as the dark ages of artificial intelligence. So basically, we had a problem. We had some nice theoretical models, some nice architectures, but we were not able to use them, at least not for solving practical problems. And then in 1999, something happened. We see the introduction of the first GPU by NVIDIA, so the computational power grew. And then in 2012, there is something that I'm labeling as the ImageNet breakthrough. So ImageNet in computer vision is a huge collection of millions of images with labels, like with the categories attached onto them. So this is a huge amount of data that you can use as a training set in your machine learning machinery. And these, together with the computational power, allowed us to finally apply these machine learning techniques to solve real problems. Okay, so here we see what happened in 2012 with this particular paper by Begrishevsky and co-authors. So this is a particular task in computer vision. It's called image recognition. So basically, you're given a picture, and you have to predict what is depicted in this picture. Like a picture of a cat, you should say, this is a cat. Okay. So axiomatic modeling allowed to get accuracy up to, I don't know, 27% in error. And after the deep learning era, so after the introduction of this particular paper, we had an improvement of like 40%. And now we have reached a point in which the artificial intelligence is much better than us, humans, at this particular task of image recognition. I mean, this is very surprising. All right, so what's the key thing that we're going to see today? So traditional machine learning techniques, and once again, I'm referring mostly to deep learning techniques, they operate on Euclidean structures. Okay, so they're being adopted for speech recognition or speech processing. So this is a one-dimensional signal, so a real function, or to images. So these are two-dimensional, so signals defined on two-dimensional flat domains. So once again, Euclidean structures, Euclidean domains. Similarly, text, a poem, can be seen as a one-dimensional signal with respect to some given set of symbols. So what we're interested in is trying to apply these techniques to data that lies on non-Euclidean domains, like on graphs, like social networks, or functional networks of the brain, or in our particular case, three-dimensional shapes, like representations of two-dimensional manifolds embedded in our truth. And we will see that this transition going from the flat domain to curved domains is not trivial at all. So this is what we're going to explore today. Okay, so this is the key question driving the entire tutorial. So how can we design deep neural networks? How can we apply machine learning to deal with non-Euclidean domains, such as surfaces? And what can we do with them? So this is very important. So we need to have interesting applications. Okay, so here I'm giving you some prototypical non-Euclidean objects that we encounter in practice. So there is this network analysis community. They usually deal with graphs representing like social networks like Facebook. In our case, we usually look at manifolds embedded in our tree. So in practice, we will be working with polygonal meshes or with point clouds embedded in our tree. Okay, so I would like to start by fixing some key notions that need to be made clear. So this might sound trivial, but it's important to pin it down. So what's the difference between the domain structure and the data lying on top of this domain? So here I'm representing this small social network. So we have people connected by those edges. And the topology of the social network, namely the graph that represents the social network, this is what I call the domain structure. Okay? So a collection of nodes and edges. And then on top of this structure, we have some information. For example, at each vertex, we might have the gender of a person, its age, or the job, and so on. And edges might be representing some notion of friendship, or some, I don't know, some commutation frequency between the job places, and so on. Okay? And so, and these are referred to as data in our domain. All right, so this might be a little bit more eloquent. So traditionally, when we think of images, we don't think of the domain, right? So the domain is boring, it's the same for all images. It's a section of the plane, the two-dimensional plane. So when we think of images, we think of the signal, so the color, which is defined on the domain. When we think of these shapes, very frequently, we don't even have a signal which lies on top of the domain. So very frequently, we don't have the texture of the 3D model. So when we say 3D shapes, we mean the domain itself. So this is a key difference. So traditional deep learning works on signals defined on the domain that is the same for all images. And we are going to have a shift in paradigm. So we have to work with the domain itself. Okay, so this is already a tricky part. So it's not obvious how to do it. All right, so another key notion to pin down is this difference between a fixed domain and a different domain. So let's take again this example of a social network. So here we have a social network, which is represented as a graph, and then we have different kinds of data lying on top of this graph. And maybe we want to learn something about the people that are living in this social network. Okay, so we gathered some training data, and then we would like to conclude something about them, or to predict something about them. Like, we want to predict this guy who is going to vote at the elections, for instance. And when we do this, we assume the graph to stay the same. So it's going to be a fixed domain. It's not going to change. Or at least we're not interested in modeling the formations of the graph. On the other hand, in our field, in graphics and geometry processing, very often we have different realizations of the same physical object. So we have different embeddings of a two-dimensional manifold in our tree. So what we would like to do, we would like to generalize whatever we learn on one shape to other poses of the same shape. And so we would like to stay invariant to the change of course. So here we're dealing with actually different domains. All right, so one thing I would like to make clear is that geometric learning, which is what I'm going to talk about today, is different than manifold learning. So like in computer vision and in pattern recognition, we have this problem of manifold learning. Basically, the idea is that you're given a set of points, and you assume this point is a sampling of some underlying manifold, which is unknown, and you try to reconstruct this underlying manifold. And this is called manifold learning. It doesn't have anything to do with geometric learning. Okay? So what we do, basically, we do learning on manifolds. And this is manifold learning. A fortunate choice of a nomenclature. All right, so we will see today different formulations of non-Euclidean deep learning. We will have formulations operating in the spectral domain. So this is something that Max briefly introduced earlier. So working in the spectral domain, namely in the eigenspaces of the notation. Then we see formulations operating in the spatial domain, so on the embedding itself in R3. And this is a very new direction. This will be presented at SIGGRAPH this year. So formulations working in some embedding domain. Formulations providing working on some global parameterization of the surface. Okay. So we will see all three formulations. All right, so I'm not going to assume that you know deep learning or that you have, you know, the key notions of neural networks, so I'm going to cover the mathematical preliminaries. And of course, at any point, if you would like to interrupt or ask questions, of course, feel free. All right, so we're going to talk about supervised learning. So what do we mean by that? So we will start by representing our data as data vectors, F, in some high-dimensional space, Euclidean. For example, in the case of images, each such data vector is an image, like the collection of pixels stacked up to form a column vector. And then we assume that there is some classification functional that we would like to solve for. This is the unknown. For instance, in an image recognition problem, we would like to find this function Y, which takes an image and then tells us whether this image is depicting a cat or a dog or a horse and so on. Okay, so the codomain of this functional is some discrete set of labels. This is the unknown. This is what we're looking for. We're looking for such function. And then we assume, and this is the supervised part of supervised learning, we assume to be given some training set. Basically, we have an observation of this function Y on some sparse inputs, fi. Okay, so we know for certain inputs, we know exactly what is the correct label that we associate to that input. And now the idea is that given this training set, we would like to solve for the complete function Y. So in some sense, we would like to interpolate the rest. Of course, the more training samples we have, well, the more information we have about this function. So the more examples, the better. And what we're going to do, we're going to model this function Y by using a parametric model. So the optimization variables in the end will be the parameters of this function. So this will become very clear in a couple of slides. So supervised learning or machine learning in general is an optimization problem. Okay, so you are trying to solve for some unknown function, or in particular for some unknown set of parameters for this function that minimize some energy. And in machine learning jargon, this is what we call a loss function. Okay, and of course, this loss depends on the particular task that you are trying to solve. We will see several examples of choices, possible choices for the loss function. Okay, so let's start by talking about neural networks. So I'm not going to, so the reason why it's called neural network is because when it was introduced at the beginning, there were a lot of analogies with how the brain works. So the perception, the neurons and so on. I'm not going to use any of these notions. Okay, so neural network is just a name for us. So this is how it works. So we have some input F, for instance, the red channel of an image. So this is some input, and we're going to claim that the output that we're trying to predict can be represented as a linear combination of the input. Okay, so we have these linear combination coefficients W, which when we use of course, linearly with our input will give us the output that we're looking for. Of course, this is a super simple model, so in general, you cannot expect that any output can be obtained linearly from the input. So this is super boring. So we're going to make things a little bit more interesting by applying a non-linear function, this psi outside over here, to the output of the linear operation. Okay, and this non-linear function can be added. You choose your non-linear function. There are some popular choices for certain good reasons. For instance, this ReLU unit, this is just taking the maximum between the input and zero. This is a non-linear function, a very simple one. And now, suddenly, this simple model becomes more interesting. So it's actually the composition of linear map and non-linear map is, in general, non-linear. And then we're going to concatenate several such layers, and our final function will be the composition of these atomic nonlinear and linear maps. Okay? And well, this is in general a nonlinear function. And what we want to do, we want to solve for this set of parameters. And these are exactly the weights that appear in the linear combinations that I showed at the beginning. Okay? All right, so now there is some nice theory. So not too much theory, as you can imagine, in machine learning and deep neural networks, but there is some nice results. So basically, there is this universal approximation theorem. So intuitively, it's saying that one simple neural network just consisting of one layer can approximate arbitrarily well any continuous function. Okay, so this model is super powerful. So one layer can approximate any continuous function. If you concatenate more layers, you get maybe more properties, like differentiable functions and so on. Now, so this seems very powerful, but it leaves some open questions. Like, for instance, first of all, we have to optimize for these parameters. So how do we do that? Yes?
While this is a very powerful
Well, maybe it's a trigger.
Yeah. No, that's not the point. The point is, it's also the reason why it's significant in the sense it there's no guarantee on how much overfitting it will do.
Exactly. Yeah. So as Nicole was suggesting, there is no guarantee on how much overfitting it will do. So what does it mean, overfitting? Maybe we're going to learn the parameters that minimize our loss function on the training set. But the moment we applied on new data that we didn't observe before, maybe this was not the function that we were looking for, after all. So it was overfitting on training data. So we would like our functions, so the function that we solve for, we would like them to generalize well to unobserved data. So this is a challenging point. Max?
So in this theorem, the n depends on f, or n is independent of f?
N depends on f, but you don't know n.
Right, but it's actually saying that any function can be represented as a like almost linear function in sufficiently high dimension.
Mm-hmm. It is true, yeah. So actually I had a slide before depicting this thing. Yeah. Alright, and another thing is that, so until this theorem speaks about single layer networks, but single-layer networks in practice do not work well when we have high-dimensional data like images or point clouds or you name it, any other representation. So in practice, we will be considering deep network. So why do we call it a network a deep network? Because we concatenate several such layers. So nothing more. All right, so the idea now is that we can try to solve, in some sense, these problems over here by taking advantage of the structure of the data. So what do I mean by that? So first of all, let's think of images for the background part. So if we look at an image, we can observe that there are certain patches which are repeated, which we encounter very often across the image, like this. Yeah. So here, this yellow window over here, the photometric information that is contained within the window, we see several times across the image. And similarly for several other patterns. So in this notion of self-similarity, we usually refer to as stationarity. And we want to take advantage of this fact. So in images, this is what we're going to observe. Let's try to leverage this fact. Now, what we're going to do, we're going to design some kernels, some small functions. I'm going to be more precise about this choice of a name. We're going to design some small functions that we shift across the image. And as we shift it across the image, we record some response that the image gives when it is applied to this function. Okay, so in particular, if we have this function going through the image, similar patches will give a similar response. And this is, so usually we say in jargon that the two patches share this kernel that we shift across the image, and this gives rise to this notion of weight sharing from neural networks. Okay, so when I talk about weight sharing, I mean that patches will give similar response when they are applied to this particular function. Okay, so just to make you notice that if we design these small patches that we shift across the image, then these patches are going to have a fixed dimension, and this is very good. So we have these kernels which have a fixed dimension, and these coefficients representing these kernels will be our unknowns, and this is a fixed number independent on the resolution of the image. Okay. All right, so we have order of one parameters per filter. Now, one thing that very frequently we would like to have, at least in several applications, is translation invariance. So like in image classification, you would like to say that this picture is a cat, independent on where it appears in the image domain, right? So basically, we would like to attain translation invariance. So formally, I'm defining an operator, a translation operator TV, and TV operates on functions f in this way. So it's shifting the input by some amount v, and then computing the function at the shifted input. Okay. So I would like you to note that in order for this translation operator to make sense, we need a notion of translation in the first place. And this notion of translation should be a property of the domain. So for images, it's trivial, right? Translation, so images are vector spaces, basically. So we can translate points on the image domain. And you can already imagine that the moment we will consider signals or manifolds, defining a meaningful notion of translation is not trivial at all. Okay? Right, so what we're going to use in order to implement these notions, translation invariance, locality, and self-similarity, we're going to introduce the operation of the convolution operation. So I'm sure all of you are familiar with this notion. So intuitively, once again, convolving some small window, some signal with another one, is equivalent to taking one of the two signals and then shifting it across the other one. And every time we shift it, we record the correlation at that point. Okay. And this will give us a new signal, which is the convolution of the two original signals. And this convolution operation is shift invariant. So we have translation invariance, like for free, and it's local if we use a small window, which we convolve with the image. And in particular, if we have similar features across the image, then the response of the convolution will be the same if the two regions are the same. So this is the stationarity property that we were looking for. All right, so another thing, and this is one of the key things of convolutional neural network, is that we rely on the assumption of the data being compositional. So basically, I'm going to claim that most natural images are composed by an aggregation of features. And these features form some hierarchical structure. So for instance, across this hierarchy, we will see at the bottom level, like very low level features like corners and edges and so on. And then as we go deeper into the hierarchy, we will see some agglomerations of these features. So we will see circles, some more interesting curves. So here is some more semantic example. We're looking at eyes, noses, mouths, and at the higher levels, we start seeing faces, okay? And It turns out that CNNs, so convolutional neural networks, naturally extract such features from the data. And this is quite interesting. Okay, so now what is a convolutional neural network? So it's basically just the same principle as before, but exactly the same thing, but we're just replacing the linear operation that we had over here with a convolution. Okay, and that's it. And then we concatenate several such layers and we have our deep CNN. And now the unknowns in this model are the weights of the convolution kernel. So which particular kernel we have to use for the convolution, this is the unknown. We're looking for those numbers in the kernel. All right, so usually there is also one other classical ingredient in convolutional neural networks, and it is this thing that I'm calling the pooling layer. So it's a very simple operation. So this is our input image, and then let's say that we are applying to it this particular filter. So we are convolving these two signals, and this is the result. A pooling layer, basically, it's just producing a downscaled version of this result. Okay, so for example, you can do max pooling, so you split the feature map into several blocks, and then for each block you take the maximum, for instance. So just implementing the idea of downscaling. Why do we want to downscale in the first place? Well, first of all, we gain some resilience to small high-frequency deformations, right? So it is something that you would like to have. Or secondly, I don't know, we gain resilience to the resolution of the image, right? So if anyway we're going to rescale everything, then whatever, right? And last but not least, well, we reduce the number of unknowns. Okay, so it's also a scalability argument. Okay, so typically deep CNNs are an architecture including several such ingredients. So we have convolutions, maybe you can bring back some completely linear layers inside the architecture, then you have some pooling operations. Well, how to design exactly a network for some specific task, this is an open question, and I don't know the answer to it. So usually you just try everything until it works. So this I don't like, but this is how it's working in computer vision currently. So questions until now? Cool. So to recap, key properties of CNNs. So we're going to use convolutional filters, and this is a plus because we gain translation invariance. And we're going to have multiple layers, so we extract this compositional structure of the data. This is pretty cool. And then filters are localized in space, so we have locality. We have weight sharing, so this is what I called stationarity or self-similarity at the beginning. We have a constant number of parameters per filter, so it doesn't depend on the resolution of the image. And then, so the filtering itself is done in a special domain as linear complexity, which is good. I mean, better than quadratic, so good. And then, usually for classification tasks, you can use like log n layers, and you will get stable unprecedented results in this particular application. Okay, so finally, 25 minutes into the tutorial, we're going to talk about geometry. Okay, so we have seen about machine learning, how can we apply these techniques to geometric data? This is what you're here for, right? So I'm going to start with what we refer to as extrinsic methods. So what's the most trivial way of applying these techniques to 3D shapes? You produce virtual snapshots of your 3D shape, so you have a collection of images representing your 3D model, and on each image you can apply classical 2D Euclidean convolutional neural networks. Well, good idea, why not? Right? There are some problems. Well, first of all, we need to have some consistent orientation for our objects, or you have to take snapshots from all possible point of views, so this is more a technical problem. Secondly, you can imagine that if you deform the shape, well, taking a snapshot doesn't make much sense, right? So whatever you learn about this deformed shape will not work for another version of the same shape, not a different deformation. This is because taking a snapshot is an extrinsic operation. It depends on the embedding of the manifold in the embedding space in R3. Okay, so this was actually a solution. This was proposed by Hao Su and Galogiragis and others. I don't know if they're here. No, I don't see them. But this works very well for some particular applications. For example, shape retrieval. Right, so if you want to look for chairs in a database of chairs, then I mean you're not assuming chairs to be formed significantly, so why not? You can use this. And this is exactly, yeah, so this is just an example of the architecture. So this is what they use for. And they had like super state-of-the-art results just by using the simple idea. So given a chair, the task is to predict whether it's a chair or not. Well, not something more challenging than this, but classification task. And then, so since you're taking snapshots, virtual snapshots with a virtual camera, then you can just change the rendering, the way in which you render the snapshot, right? So you can make it so that it looks like a sketch drawn by a person. And this allows you to classify sketches. And even cooler, you can do 3D shape retrieval from sketches. And you see that this is coming like very naturally from this particular framework, from this particular solution. Right? So you train with sketches or with sketchy renderings of snapshots, and then you can retrieve three-dimensional models out of it. All right, so second possible solution. So and this is completely extrinsic, right? You agree? Cool. So, second possible solution, we represent 3D shapes as collections of voxels. So, like a discretization of a three-dimensional manifold embedded in R3. And then we can apply 3D notion of convolution. So, this is something we have from classical signal processes. We're still in Euclidean space, we can do 3D convolution. And by 3D, I mean volume, right? So, we have voxel grids representing the shapes. And then with these, we can once again, do I have it now? So you can once again design some deep neural network in which you replace the convolution step with a 3D convolution. So this works very well also. So it was the same year as the previous approach was proposed. And now, so what I'm going to do here, I'm going to show you these basic features that are extracted by the neural network as you go through the network. So at the low level, we see elementary features like corners and then faces, edges, and so on. And as you go deeper into the network, you start seeing, so this is layer number two, you start seeing some more interesting features like compositions of faces and so on, until you get some more meaningful objects. So like this a trash bin or a computer screen and so on. So this is the analogy to that image I showed you at the beginning with the faces showing up as we go through the network. All right, third and last example, just to give you an idea of what you can do extrinsically. So this is a very challenging problem in shape analysis. You're given three-dimensional shape, like this dog, and then you're given deformation of the dog, which is also partial, so you only see a part of this dog. And in addition, there is also clutter, like extraneous geometry. Your task is to detect the dog in the scene and densely correspond it to the first model. Super difficult. I mean, Max gave this cool talk about how to solve the problem if the second dog is complete and there is no clutter. And that's already difficult. So imagine if a partiality and clutter. Super challenging problem. I mean, it makes sense to try to learn from the data how you can solve this problem instead of doing everything axiomatically. All right, so this is what you can do. So you can assume to be given a training set, so you know exactly where this cat corresponds to in the scene, and then you construct a set of positive examples, so like knowingly correct matches of this x and x plus, and then a set of negative examples, like x with all the red points, these are wrong matches. So that's a negative example, this is not what you want. Then what you do, you want, so you assume that each point has associated some local descriptor that you pre-computed, curvature or heat kernel signature, whatever. And now you want to learn a new metric, a distance function between descriptors, such that this new distance must be small for positive examples. So correct matches should have small distance in the descriptor space, and it must be large for negative examples. So wrong matches must have large distance in the descriptor space. Okay? So and this is called a metric learning problem. And in practice, you can phrase the metric learning problem slightly differently. So basically, the idea is that instead of learning a metric, you learn a nonlinear transformation of the input data, of the input descriptor, and then on the nonlinearly transformed descriptors, you take the classical L2 metric. Okay. So you can be shown that this is equivalent to learning a new metric. And now, this nonlinear transformation of theta, it can be implemented as a deep neural network. Right? So we can forget about convolutions, so like just deep neural network, all linear layers with these nonlinearities, just a way of implementing a generic nonlinear function. Okay. And now, of course, you have to set up the loss function that you're going to minimize. So you want to minimize some energy, and the energy you want to minimize is the following. This is also called the Siamese loss for certain reasons. So you want your new descriptors to have small distance for knowingly correctly matching points. And the wrong matches should be far away from these couplings. So they should be at a safe margin. And the safe margin is expressed by this margin coefficient here, this ns. Okay, so this is what you want to minimize. This is what you want your nonlinear function to minimize. Well, this you can ignore. So you can see that here the geometry itself is never showing up in the pipeline. Am I using the geometry in any way? No, right? So I'm still operating in the Euclidean domain. I'm assuming I'm operating in the descriptor space. And representing the descriptors as vectors in RK, in K high dimension. All right, so yeah, so if you now do the training, so you solve the optimization problem, and then you use the trained machine to compute the descriptors for new shapes, and then you simply associate each point on one shape to the closest one in the other shape in the descriptor space, in the new descriptor space, you get correspondences. And here I'm depicting corresponding points by the same color, and you see that you get super good results. But maybe some mismatches are hidden in the smooth coloring, but you can see that this smooth color texture is well transferred on the other shape. Okay, so this is a very simple idea, and it works beautifully. And surprisingly, we're not using any geometry in the process. Nice.
Maybe you mentioned this. So how much training data do you need, and how does it depend
on the... So that's one of the open questions. So very often deep learning works well if you have a lot of training data, like millions of examples. In this particular case, we didn't have millions of examples. So maybe 100,000. But keep in mind that for us it's easier because our training data is the set of matches and mismatches, but that's easier for us. In general, there is a very strong dependence on the amount of training data.
And like in this application, did you see, like at some point, you know, it just starts working, is it binary, or like you sort of keeps on increasing?
No, it's not binary, but so I'm not, I didn't do the training myself, so I would have to ask Jonathan. But yeah. Yes?
There's a bigger problem here, as I see, which is the notion of scale, because the positive examples are easier in some sense, but we're requiring to give some negative examples, and at some scale, very reasonable scale, we expect that some part of the dog to look similar to the gorilla or the human, right? And we are telling them just by based on labels they are negative examples. So this is what we want, right? So this is related to Max's question: the more volume of data we expect, we implicitly require some knowledge of negative examples. This is not very obvious.
First of all, so to be honest, this is not the straight result from matching the learned descriptors. They will give rise, for example, this part of the log will be matched to this part of the centaur, exactly what you're saying. So here I'm applying some regularization, more or less. So secondly, so yes, this problem is there. There is no trivial way, I mean, no obvious way to me to solve it. Definitely having more data will solve it.
But this is chicken and egg in a way, right? If I didn't get the data, then you need to explain the data.
It is, yeah. That's a problem, I agree. I don't have a solution for you yet. But
you showed it before, because very nice for the 3D examples, you have different levels, and at some level we saw corners and this. This would be similar for chairs and tables and different objects. So they're not negative examples at that scale. Only if you go up in scale, they start to be negative examples.
That's true. So, but then, I mean, the input descriptor G, you can define it multi-scale. So this will capture, this is a possible solution.
Yeah. You can also use that augmentation. You can rotate the model on scale.
We did it.
Yeah.
We did dot augmentation here. So basically, dot augmentation means that you can produce new training data from what you already have. In this particular case, the problem is partiality and clutter. We can introduce more partiality. That's easy. So you rotate the shapes or you remove more parts, and this produces new data. Yeah. Good point.
There was another question there.
I think it was him. No?
I don't know.
Exactly. Oh, okay. Cool. That's a nice trick. Yeah, same question. But... okay, so some more examples. You can trust me, it works quite well with regularization. But the regularization, by the way, is done with functional maps. So that's actually useful. Thank you. Okay, so now, so this was the extrinsic part. So not using the geometry of the shape, we're just using the geometry of the embedded space. Now we're going non-Euclidean. So we're going to see what we can do with the shapes that we have, with the manifold, for data lying on the manifold, and so forth. Okay, so what are the main challenges? Well, first of all, we need to define a meaningful notion of convolution, not trivial. We need to define how to do pooling, how to make it work fast, and in particular, we can rely on the assumption or on the observation that also for non-Euclidean data, we have this compositionality property. So I'm going to claim that three-dimensional objects or non-Euclidean data in general will consist of local self-similar and hierarchical structures. Okay. Key assumption. If you don't rely on this assumption, most of this deep neural network machinery doesn't work as well as you would like it to work. Okay, so once again, for typical non-Euclidean objects will be graphs and manifolds. I'm going to concentrate on manifolds, in particular on polygonal meshes representing two manifolds in R3 and on point clouds representing manifolds in R3. All right, so this is something that Max also mentioned at the beginning, so I'm going to skim through it. Basically, for discrete manifolds, I'm going to consider point clouds, and here what I'm showing is the nearest neighbor graph of point clouds. For point clouds can be represented as graphs. And for our manifolds, we're going to use this triangular mesh representation, and I'm only going to use the assumption that it is a manifold mesh. So each edge is shared by two faces. All right, so I'm going to make use of this tool, which is the Laplacian that Max also introduced before. So why is it useful? Well, to begin with, it allows us to generalize the ideas of Fourier analysis from classical Euclidean signals to signals defined on manifolds. So the eigenfunctions of the Laplacian form in the Euclidean setting for the standard Fourier basis. And for in our setting, these are the first few eigenfunctions of the Laplace Beltrami operator, and these are the first few harmonics in the Fourier expansion for functions defined on manifolds. So Max said that very similar to you. All right, so, and this is the same thing on graphs. So also for graphs, we can define some structure of the Laplacian, and then we can compute eigenfunctions, and there we go, we have our harmonics on graphs. And this is the first part of my geography test. Can you recognize this thing? You should know, yeah, I know, you know. Anybody?
Oh.
So, Alec,
Minnesota.
Minnesota.
Say the French flag.
It was not. It was a German colony or something, not a French colony.
Yeah, people were, well, there were French too, but a lot of Germans moved there, yeah.
All right, so, yeah, Minnesota. Not important for the tutorial, but... Okay, so, once again, free analysis. Max showed this example before, so we can express L2 functions as linear combinations of harmonics or Laplacian eigenfunctions. This is the 1D case. Yeah, so here we have the transform. So we have inner products between the signal and the basis functions. And then we have here the linear combination of those gives us our signal. And in the manifold case, it's just the same. So we have scalar functions defined on the manifold. They can be expressed as linear combinations of the Laplacian eigenfunctions. Okay, so if you never worked with these tools before, I mean, computing the Laplacian, computing the eigenfunctions, is an extremely easy problem. So this you can do very easily. And Max is also providing some code on the functional maps course. All right, so next key notion is the notion of convolution. So I'm going to be a little bit more precise than before because this is now very important. So in the Euclidean case, in the 1D and one-dimensional real signals case, we define convolution this way. So the convolution between f and g is itself a function, f convolved with g computed at x, which is obtained at each point x by computing this integral. So you see here we are fixing one of the two functions, f, and then we're translating the other function over the other signal, and then we're recording the correlation between the two signals at each position. This is convolution. So properties of convolution is shift invariant. This I suggested at the beginning. Shift invariance meaning that you can shift and then convolve, or convolve and shift, and you get exactly the same result. It's a property of convolution. It commutes with the Laplacian, but I'm not going to use this property. So maybe it's just fun fact, it commutes with the Laplacian. And then convolution theorem. This is a very important result from signal processing. So it says that the Fourier transform diagonalizes the convolution operator. What does it mean? In words, it means that you can compute the convolution between two signals equivalently in space or in frequency. And in frequency is just given by the product of the Fourier transforms of the two signals. So very, very useful. And in particular, yes. So if you want to transition from the space domain to the Fourier domain, in the Euclidean case, you can do it super efficiently by using the fast Fourier transform algorithms. And so, I mean, this is faster than computing the convolution directly in space. So now, in the discrete case, we are going to represent functions as vectors. So our function f is just this vector of coefficients at 1fn, and then same thing for g. And then convolution between f and g can be realized by this matrix vector multiplication. So here on the right, we see the first function. Here on the left, we see the second function, and this is repeated at each row, but each time it's shifted by one, okay? With circular boundary conditions on the matrix, see? And of course, I mean, this is why it's called the circulant matrix. So if you look at this, now if you compute this matrix vector product, you will see that you are going to get exactly the convolution of the two signals. It should be quite easy to see. Now, the circulant matrix is diagonalized by the Fourier basis. What does it mean? It means that if we represent it in the Fourier basis, then we have this diagonal matrix here in the middle. And this diagonal matrix contains the Fourier coefficients of the second function. Okay, so this is just the change of basis going from spatial to frequency and back. All right, now we have this phi transpose f. This is just projecting f onto the eigen basis of the Laplacian. So these are the spectral coefficients of the first signal. And then this means that we are just computing the product of the two sets of spectral coefficients. And then we synthesize back. So we go back to the spatial domain. So this is the convolution theorem in the discrete case. Just to show you that, first of all, it works. Secondly, you mean you need a circular matrix which is diagonalized by the Laplacian. And this will be important later. Okay, so now we can attempt to generalize the notion of convolution to functions defined on curved spaces. And we're going to use this property of convolution as a definition for convolution. Not a good thing to do in general, but this is what we're going to do here. Let's see if it works well. So we're given two functions on some manifold X, or in some functional space L2 on X. And here we're defining convolution between F and G as the product of the Fourier transforms of the two functions. See? So this is projection onto the Laplacian eigenbasis, and here we're just taking the product. And then we're synthesizing back to go to the spatial domain. Product in the Fourier domain, and then inverse Fourier transform. Okay. So this is going to be our generalized convolution. So generalized convolution is a name we made up. So we don't claim that this is an actual convolution operation. So yeah, matrix vector notation, projection onto the eigenbasis, element-wise product, and then synthesize. And this can be written in this form. So we have this diagonal matrix with the spectral coefficients along the diagonal. We were going to go G. If it's a real convolution, then G should be a circulant matrix. It's not. Which means that this definition of convolution gives rise to an operation that is not shifting diagonal. This was one of the key properties that we wanted for our neural networks. Okay? So it seems like, at least proceeding this way, we do not obtain a meaningful notion of convolution for functions defined on manifolds. Okay, yeah, commutes with the flash. All right, so still, this maybe in practice this will work well. Okay, so this is what I'm going to explore now. And I just want to say that when you do deep learning, then one of these two functions is the input data, some signal defined on your surface, and the other function is the filter that you convolve with this data. Like G is going to be your filter. And when you take this spectral view, you're going to learn the Fourier coefficients of the filter. Okay, you're not going to learn the filter in the spatial domain, you're going to learn the filter in the Fourier domain. Okay, and this gives rise to this family of methods called spectral domain deep learning methods. So the first one, yeah, was proposed very recently, so 2014, by Jean Bruna and co-authors. So the idea is that you have this convolutional layer in your network, and whenever you have to do your convolution, you are convolving with a filter which is defined in the spectral domain. So you have the spectral coefficients W identifying your filter. Alright, so this is a direct matrix of filter coefficients. And the unknown in the CNN will be this matrix W. So you're going to solve for the spectral coefficients. Now, the filters are basis dependent in the sense that spectral coefficients only make sense in this particular basis phi. If you now change the basis, you plug in another basis coming from another domain, then these coefficients, these numbers here, do not make any sense, right? Because they're defined with respect to these basis. And this means that these filters that you learn on one shape will not be valid for other shapes. I will show you an example of this.
You mean that the filter base will not be valid in another basis, or they need to be transferred to another basis?
I will show it. Thanks, the excellent point. Yeah. Well, then you have n parameters per layer, because I mean this matrix is k by k, by n layer. It's a mistake, I think. Yeah, but yeah, more than linear. No, linear. Okay, never mind this thing, I think it's wrong. And yeah, and well, the big problem is that you don't have fast Fourier transform algorithms on graphs and on manifolds. Okay, so basically you don't have n log n complexity, you have like n squared complexity. And there is no guarantee of spatial localization of filters. So the key property that we discussed for standard CNNs is that the filter is localized. So it's like identifying patches on the image. Here we're operating in the spectral domain. When we synthesize it back to the spatial domain, we might get a filter that is all spread over the surface. So how can we guarantee compactness of the filter in the spatial domain? So you don't have it for free. So, example of why spectral filters do not generalize well, or of how they do not generalize well. So here I'm showing some function f on a surface, and then I design a filter that does some edge detection on the surface. And I'm going to represent this filter in the spectral basis. So the filter is defined by these weights w. Now I'm going to change the domain. I'm going to take another course in another pose. So it's an approximately isometric deformation. And I'm going to hope that when I apply these weights w to the new basis of the new domain, I will still have an edge detection of the function. And this is what happens. You see, so I don't see any edge detection happening on the horse. So what I'm doing, I'm using the weights w, which were defined with respect to the previous basis, and I'm using them in this new basis. M psi, well, is a new basis for each of the poses along this animation. Okay. So it doesn't work well. So it means that it doesn't. So these filters do not make sense in a different basis. So now, well, first I have another example. Yeah, so to reinforce this message, here I'm showing the 50th basis function across several poses, and you see that it changes all the time. Okay, so the basis is changing as you deform the shape. You might be thinking, yeah, but the Laplacian eigenspaces are invariant to isometric deformations, right? So it shouldn't change so much. Well, but these are not exactly isometric deformations. And in fact, there are enough non-isometric that this thing doesn't work at all. Okay, so as Miloy was suggesting, if you have a way of establishing some correspondence between these eigenbases and these eigenbases, then let's say that this transferring of information can be done linear. So this correspondence can be done linearly, then you can apply this linear transformation, and then you can apply filters on this shape to also operate on this shape over here. And then guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to define some canonical domains, an intermediate domain, and I'm going to correspond both of them, both the two shapes, to this canonical domain, and I'm going to use it as an intermediate step to transfer from one shape to the other. Okay? And this I'm going to do with functional maps. So functional maps, if you recall from my presentation, they are basically aligning spectral embeddings of the two shapes. And aligning spectral embeddings means aligning the eigenbases, or the eigenspaces of the two manifolds. So this is a very technical thing. I just want to tell you that, so, and this is very recent, actually, it's going to be presented at CBPR this year. So this is a work by Hao Su, Yo Vivas, and co-authors. Just want to give you the idea that, in general, even though spectral coefficients computed here cannot be used over here, if you know how to transfer them, then you can do it. And transferring them is a correspondence problem in the spectral domain, so functional maps. Okay. A couple of words about smoothness. So I said that we have filters in the spectral domain that do not necessarily correspond to compact filters in the spatial domain. Well, in free analysis, we have this classical result. So this is a combination of two results. The first result is this relation between derivatives in the spectral domain and moments in the spatial domain. Also, the other relationship also works. The second result is this identity of the energies of the two functions, and this is called Parseval identity. So what this is buying us is that basically if you have something that is smooth in frequency, it's going to be compact in space. And vice versa, if you have something that is smooth in space, it's going to be compact in frequency. So this is extremely cool, because you, if you want to have some compact filter in the spatial domain, then you can introduce a smoothness prior somehow in your learning process. So, and you're going to, if in the end you really solve for smooth filters, you should get compact filters in the spatial domain. So, and this was also quite recent, like 2015, a couple of years ago. And yeah, so localization in space is equivalent to smoothness in the frequency domain. So I'm not going to go too much into the details. So this can be done easily. Basically, the idea is that, so here in the middle we had this diagonal matrix of spectral coefficients. Now we are going to parameterize this signal in the Fourier domain by using some function of the eigenvalues. And this function, we're going to ask for it to be a smooth function. Okay, so basically, there is an easy way to solve for smooth spectral filters. And the idea is to parameterize them with respect to some smooth bases. Okay, so it's going to be technical. I'm going to skip it a little bit. Yeah, so you can actually prove under certain conditions that you do obtain fast decaying filters in space, exactly what we wanted, localized filters in the spatial domain. Still, you cannot do FFT on graphs or manifolds and so on, so this is going to be computationally inefficient. All right, so let's try to see what we can do in the spatial domain. So now this is going to get tricky. So let me remind you the difference between extrinsic and intrinsic. I know this is a little bit silly, but so extrinsic, this is what a filter in the extrinsic setting would look like. So it would respond differently depending on the embedding of the manifold in R3. Okay, so it's extrinsic, so it is not coherent among the formations of the cylinder. What we would like to have, a filter that is intrinsic. So this filter should operate on top of the surface. Okay, so if the surface deforms, the filter should deform with it. I have a, yes, this nice animation is visualizing the difference between extrinsic and intrinsic. This is an extrinsic filter. You see it lies in the embedding space. So this is how it operates on the deforming surface. So it's changing, it's capturing a different neighborhood each time. It's always, yeah. And this is an intrinsic filter. We want it to lie on the surface and deform with it. Okay? So we're going to try to implement this idea. And we're going to try to define a notion of convolution with these kind of filters. So what is convolution on manifolds? So I gave a few possibilities. So in the Euclidean setting, we have a well-defined notion of convolution in the spatial domain and in the spectral domain, given by the convolution theorem. Then in the non-Euclidean setting, I gave a proposal for a convolution operating in the spectral domain, and this was not shifting variant. Let's see what can we do in the spatial domain in the non-Euclidean setting. Okay, so I'm going to relate the notion of convolution with the notion of correlation. Not the same thing, but maybe in practice this is what we want to have. So in the Euclidean case, spatial convolution means that we have this fixed grid that we shift over the image and then we record correlations. So basically, maybe we need some intrinsic grid, like a geodesic grid, and then we shift it along across the surface, and then we record the correlations. Okay, so simple idea. Let's see how we can realize it. So what can we expect from such an operation? So in the spatial domain, first of all, we have a global system of coordinates. In the non-Euclidean setting, we don't always have a global system of coordinates. So what do I mean when we don't always have? I mean, there might be manifolds for which we can do it. In particular, we could provide a global parameterization of the manifold, but this will be the last part of the talk. But in general, things happen locally on manifolds. So that's the whole idea of differential geometry. So you do things locally. Then there is no regular structure, no grid structure. So in the image case, we have grid of pixels, so it fits well with GPU architectures and so on. In the surface case, we don't have such a regular structure, so it's very difficult to use specialized code for learning when you deal with shapes. Finally, no shift invariants. So we have already seen this in the spectral case, but here we can see it more intuitively, or we can visualize it. So you see that the letter B, so here it looks the same independently on where it appears in, on the domain. But here it depends on where it appears on the domain. So it's deforming differently on different parts of the surface. Okay. So this is a suggestion that basically we will not have shift invariance convolution in general for general shapes. Okay, still, we're going to do it anyway. So we're going to define a correlation operation between functions on manifolds. This is super easy. I mean, you don't need me to tell you that this can be done easy, right? So what we're going to do, we're going to define an operator. This we call H operator, the H. This batch operator is operating on functions defined on the shape. So basically, for each point, it extracts a local system of coordinates around that point. And this system of coordinates, I'm making it polar, just for simplicity reasons. And it's extracting this function f and putting it into this system of coordinates. Okay, so this is what it's doing. And now we have our filter. This will be our unknown in the CNN. And then this is going to be convolved with the extracted patch. Convolved, I mean, in quotes, not really convolved. It's going to be correlated between two patches. And the correlation is just a manifold integral. Okay. Right, so yes, this is going to be our notion of convolution in the spatial setting. So it's a bit underwhelming, you know. This seems to work very well in several cases. This was proposed in 2015 by Michael Bronstein and colleagues. And I will show you, yeah, so this was called geodesic CNN or GCNN. Basically, the idea is that this local patch is actually a geodesic grid. Okay, so you can imagine, first of all, the difficulties of computing this grid. So you need to compute exact geodesics. So especially if you want to stay as local as possible, you need to be exact. You cannot do any dijkstra. And if the mesh has some topological artifacts or some missing parts, or like if the injectivity radius is too small, you're going to have technical difficulties if you compute these geodesic patches. But still, assuming everything works well, this thing can work well. All right, you have to wait for a bit to compute all these geodesics, but still, you can do it. All right, so this is the same figure as before. Once you have it, then you can do the discorrelations. Okay, so this is how a geodesic CNN looks like. So basically, it's the same architecture as before. So we have like some fully connected layers. So these operate linearly on the input. So it's the simplest thing you can do. Then we have some pooling layers. And then we have the convolutional layers. And we're just replacing convolution with this geodesic correlation. Okay. All the rest is just the same as before. It operates with vectors. So there is no geometry involved. Okay. Now, let's see a possible application for this, like learning local descriptors. Oh, yes, both of you.
I missed something. So how do you get the descriptors to be rotation invariant?
Yes, excellent question. So you see this max over here? So basically, we are computing all rotations, and then we do max pooling. We only keep the rotation that maximizes correlation.
I mean, all rotation meaning like
how many quantize is with like 16.
Okay.
Yeah. Good point.
And then the follow-up on this, like when you do this geodesic flattening, you're also introducing some distortion. And so are you learning the distortion together with whatever signal you're trying to learn?
Well, so first of all, we keep our patches local enough. So we assume that the distortion is not going to be too strong. Secondly, it's possible that we're learning the distortion. It is.
Okay.
I don't have an answer to that, but yes.
So,
you know, I had a question also. Mm-hmm.
So, why would these geodesics have to be exact? I mean, what do we lose if it's approximate?
Well, it depends on what you mean by approximate. Like, you need to go subvertex, right? So, you want to
pass subvertex exact.
This is what I mean by exact.
Okay.
But I mean, if you go through the edges, it's not a good idea, right? What effect does the size of these patches have? I mean, creating super small patches is easy, but I guess creating larger patches would result in would lead to better results, but it's harder to do.
That's right. So we, and by we I mean Davide, we played with different radii, and we just get the 1 million results. Yes, I know it's a bit disappointing. Yes.
You solved this final max pooling like a hack a bit, but that's what image CNNs do as well. If you want rotation invariance for face detection, they also just convolve with this.
But they do it for rotation invariance of the object, and we do it for a technical problem of our definition.
But both have to do it in the end. It's not that it comes for free in an image that it has like a magic detector,
right,
for faces being upside down. In the end, it's also max pooling. It will detect it like upside and downside, and it will max on the two, and it's not more clever at all. So
that's right, yeah.
No downside, I think.
Thank you, yeah. Yeah, so learning local descriptors, we have seen this with the object in clutter setting that I showed before. So I'm going to define a set of positive examples, negative examples, exactly as before. I'm going to use exactly the same, this Siamese loss that I defined. So this is the loss we want to minimize. I'm going to realize this nonlinear function as a deep neural network. And I'm going to make it convolutional this time. Same as before, plus convolutions. And this works extremely well. So let me show you how I visualize the quality of the learned descriptors. So I don't know if you can see this white dot under the armpit of this guy, with a small white sphere over there. So there I'm computing a learned descriptor. And then I'm computing learned descriptors on the rest of the surface and on all points of all other surfaces. Then I'm taking the Euclidean distance to the descriptor computed at the white sphere. And I'm plotting this Euclidean distance as a heat map on top of the surface. So in theory, for matching points, you expect close by descriptors, you expect a blue color. And for wrong matches, you expect far away descriptors, so you expect red color. So this is done with the heat kernel signature. So this is not learning-based descriptor. It seems to work reasonably well, but there is some ambiguity. Like, so this point is matching well to the tile, for instance. Okay. This is with the wave kernel signature, so it's some improvement upon the heat kernel signature. It's a little bit better. So you see the localization gets better. So the blue spot is a less spread on the surface. And this is done with this GCNN architecture. So you see that armpits only match to armpits, more or less, so there is some noise over here. This is across several deformations. So these are different individuals, not the same person. So there is some noise, some partiality, some missing parts. So, and this brings me back to your question. So, if you want to be resilient to partiality, you want to be as local as possible. So you need to find a good trade-off in view of the kind of deformations that you're going to see. So, yeah. So this was extremely simple to implement. So just simple, up to computation of geodesics. Right. So another more interesting task: learning shape correspondence. So now the question is: given two shapes, can we predict the dense matching between the two shapes? So, and this can be done quite easily. So you can phrase the correspondence problem as a labeling problem. So basically, for each point on a query shape, you're going to predict the probability distribution, or the probability that this point corresponds to some other point on some reference shape. Reference shape is some shape taken from the training set. And this probability distribution on the shape, you can see it as a descriptor for that point. Right. Why not? So it's, in some sense, so technically speaking, this is still a descriptor learning problem. We just attach different semantics to the descriptor that we learn. So, yeah. So the output of the GCNN is the probability distribution of the reference. And then you just need to define your energy, the energy that you're minimizing. This should be a distance between descriptors. In this sense, in this case, the descriptors are probability distributions, so we take a meaningful notion of distance between probability distributions. Okay, so here we have that the ground truth probability distribution should be a delta, the correct matching point. So here, this is this delta. Okay, so this is called the logistic regression cost, just some distance between probabilities. All right, so what if we do this shape, you learn shape correspondence in this way? So this is, these are the results. I'm taking all these shapes on the right, and I'm corresponding them to this shape on the left by using, by letting the network predict the correspondence, and then plotting same colors for corresponding ones. So for approximately isometric deformations, it works well. So here you can see, so this foot is actually touching, it's actually gluing on the other leg. So there is a topological shortcut over here, and still it is able to separate well the foot from the leg. So this, attempting to model this using some axiomatic approaches, this is extremely challenging. I don't know if you have familiarity with the shape matching problem, but I mean, there is no, you need to use some semantics in order to resolve this situation. Right? So we know how to solve it because we know it's a foot. It's not supposed to get to be glued to the leg, right?
Does it assume that this type of corrections are already there in the training set? Because in the training set, if they're touching,
of course, we need it,
yeah.
So when you get the version was, if you want to be able to resolve these kind of problems, then they should be represented in the training set already. But in the training set, we did introduce such cases. And that's the whole point of learning from examples. Right? So you need to produce meaningful examples. Same thing here.
Do you have
an issue with size of your training data now? Because basically you need, instead of just having pairs of similar points, you actually have labels. So you need a large, because you basically have one example for training shape for every point. You need a large number of shapes.
But you have many points for each shape. And many, I mean.
But if you're learning the actual label, which is like where this point will, you don't have many points.
That's right, but I mean, within some neighborhood, so all labels should, so what I mean is that an example for this point would also be an example for the neighboring one.
I guess depending on the
plot. Yes.
So how many training shapes?
80. Yes, that's a good point. So yeah, once again, size of the training set is an important issue in deep learning. So this might be one of the problems that we as a community will face if we try to use these techniques for solving geometry processing problems. We need a lot of examples. Okay. So a lot like at least 10, so possibly more.
Missing out the simple equation, but maybe just to explain at least that in the image case, when we do this match pooling, as I understand, this implicitly increases the neighborhood size if you go up again. The max pooling effectively allows the kernels to see bigger and bigger neighbors.
But you're talking about not the max pooling and
here,
the relation.
In the image case.
Okay.
Right. In this case, you define the geodesic patches very low here. And but then you have, since it's a big network, you have this max pooling there.
No, so we don't do max pooling.
Ah, okay.
Yes. I didn't mention it. So we just do convolutions, no max pooling. You can define max pooling on surfaces as well. I don't know how.
But then you need the neighborhood again. You need another nested level of geodesics.
This is correct, yes.
This makes, then it gets to all the questions.
Yes, that's correct. We have time, 15 minutes. I don't know.
Yep, 10 to 15 minutes.
Okay, so I'm going to be. So just to give you a general idea. So using geodesics is not the only possible solution to define a local coordinate system for patches on a surface. So what we did, so this is skipping all the time. What we did in 2016 was to define angles instead of geodesically, we're defining angles by steering a diffusion kernel. Okay, so this is what we call anisotropic heat kernels. So basically you take some, for example, the principal curvature direction at this point, you can define anisotropic heat diffusion along this direction, so this is exactly what's happening here, and then you can do it for several different directions, and this will be our variable, our theta parameter in the local coordinate frame, and the radius is not going to be geodesic anymore, it's going to be some threshold on the amount of heat that you encounter. So like, your threshold will be 0.5, the original amount of heat, that is going to be your radius. So it is a more fuzzy notion of doing something geodesically, but it's not geodesic, it's fuzzier, right? But why do we do this? Well, first of all, it's much more efficient. So computing anisotropic diffusion on manifolds can be done very, very efficiently. And secondly, we are skipping a lot of the problems given by the topological artifacts of machines. So everything is fuzzy, so whatever. If there is a problem, probably is going to be suppressed by the fuzziness. So this seems like also a simple idea, but this gave like a huge improvement, so I'm going to skip this, in terms of quality of the task. So like in shape correspondence, it gave a huge improvement. This was the state of the art at the time, 2016. This has already been improved, like another machine learning technique. So here again, I'm visualizing shape correspondence by transferring an actual texture this time, so not just colors. So that you can see more easily if the correspondence is good or not. Okay, so there is some noise over here, but if you compare this with the quality you get out of axiomatic approaches, so this is like uncomparable, much better. But to certain axiomatic approaches, at least. Yeah, same thing for point clouds. So why does it work for point cloud? Well, we don't have to compute geodesics anymore. We just need to compute heat diffusion. So we just need the Laplace operator to be computable on point clouds. Or, I mean, you can also compute geodesics by using geodesic heat. But then, I mean, you just need the Laplace and the divergence, and then you're done. So this is why it can be used like immediately on point clouds. All right. Yeah, so some examples with partial shapes. So here we have the formation. There was a question here?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
This direction theta you need for this anisotropic diffusion, I guess you need to define that not only at the central point, but in the entire neighborhood.
That's correct.
How is that done consistent then?
Excellent question. So
if it takes too long, we can talk about it later.
No, so the quick answer, we use principal curvature. So don't hate me, so I know it's not consistent across the formations, but consistent enough to work well for anisotropic heat diffusion neural networks. Another thing you can do, and this is what we're doing now, you can take like the gradient of the average geodesic distance. It is going to be more consistent than principal curvature. But the gradient is going to be more resilient to the nearly isometric deformation. Yes, you're going to have singularities, but only at some, a few points. But that's an excellent point, yeah. Okay, so some examples with partiality. It works quite well. Yeah, so these are some extreme cases of partiality. We are predicting the correspondence correctly. Okay, last family of methods, so the last 10 slides. So embedding domain deep learning methods. This is super recent. Not presented yet. So this SIGGRAPH, as I announced. So the idea is that one possibility would be, given your surface, you can parameterize it. So you can map it to some canonical domain, and then on this domain, then you can try to apply more classical techniques. Okay, so this was done by Sinha and co-authors in 2016 in the computer vision community, CVPR. And this is now by Jeroen Lippmann and co-authors. This is going to be SIGGRAPH this year. So the hope is that once you map onto this canonical domain, you can do things more easily. Another question is, how do you compute this map? So one problem is that the parameterization itself may be non-unique. So the results may depend on how, in particular, you did this parameterization. And the map itself can introduce distortions. And then, well, it remains to see if you're going to accept these distortions in your application and so on. So I'm going to show you the solution proposed by Maron and Lippmann. I think it's quite cool, quite technical. So for the technical details, try to ask and do not guarantee that I have the answer, but Keenan might have the answer. This is an embedding problem. So first of all, the question is, convolution, which is also shift invariant on surfaces, is it possible at all? So I told you it doesn't look like it's possible. So it turns out that yes, it's possible, only for certain topologies, namely toroid. Okay. So if you have a torus, so the torus is the only closed orientable surface admitting a translational group. So this operation x minus b in the convolution is well defined on toroid. Okay, so if you know Poincaré theorem, this is a consequence of this theorem. If you don't, yeah, never mind. Okay, so CNNs can be well defined on the over the flat torus. Well defined meaning they're going to be shifting by. How do they do this? In general, we will not have surfaces with torus topology. Like, so very often we have sphere topology, like the head or the body, sphere topology. They proposed a way of covering the torus, of covering the torus with replicas of a sphere topological surface. So listen to this. Basically, the idea is that given a shape with sphere topology and given 3 points on this shape, then you can use these 3 points as anchors, as landmarks, to cover the torus. So this is a flat torus. So you can imagine cyclic boundary conditions on this square. But you cannot do it, obviously, you cannot compute homeomorphism between sphere and torus. But you can replicate the surface 4 times. I don't know if you can see them. You see 4 faces over here. So basically, the surface is replicated 4 times, and in some particular way, they are tied together, and then they can be mapped to the flat torus. Quite technical. For questions, feel free to ask Kim. All right, so the paper is actually quite well explained. All right, so once you have this mapping, first of all, you have to map this embedding to the flat torus, and this you can do conformally. And once you are on the flat torus, then you can apply standard Euclidean to the CNNs, and you get shift invariance. So let me give you a visualization of how it looks like. So basically, this is how the parameterization would look like. So this is the torus, and then we have a parameterization bringing us from the flat torus back to our surface. And this is how it operates on these orthogonal directions on the surface. You see that there is, so the mapping is conformal. The mapping is conformal, meaning it doesn't preserve areas. So we're going to see scale changes across the surface. But in particular, we have a well-defined notion of translation. So we have a well-defined notion of right neighbor on the torus. And the right neighbor on the torus will be like this patch over here. And with respect to this notion of translation, you can define convolution. So now this conformality introducing scale changes, this has this magnifying glass effect, this conformal zoom effect. So you can reinterpret this deformation as using a magnifying glass on this part of the surface. And basically, this means that you can redo this mapping thing several times for different choices of triplets of points. And then you can then aggregate the outputs for each choice and get your final solution. So this here in particular is a segmentation task. And this is solved by aggregating predictions from several mappings. Okay, so this is quite cool. So there are some cons to this approach. First of all, it requires sphere topology of the surface, but on the other hand, we have a well-defined convolution on surfaces. This is a big deal. Right, so they only show examples with segmentation, maybe a bit disappointing, but still, it works. It shows that it works. So it's some segmentation results. So like, you can see that, so they only trained on humans, and then they get segmentations on non-humans that resemble what we as humans would segment those. Somehow, yeah. They're not responsible for the... Okay. Right, conclusions and then second test of geography. So we have seen application and extraction of deep learning methods to geometric and non-Euclidean data. I hope this is what you came here for. And so the key thing, the key take-home message is that deep learning allows to model invariance from data, and these invariance may be impossible to model axiomatically. So this is the key thing. We don't want to use deep learning to solve problems that we can solve otherwise. We want to use deep learning to solve problems that cannot be solved otherwise. Or to improve problems that can be solved otherwise. So there are two schools of thought. And in graphics, this last year or last 2 years, it was almost an ignored field. Now it's almost a virgin field, but it's developing quite rapidly. So at SIGGRAPH this year, there are a few papers using deep learning. And so we are looking for new applications. I mean, you are looking for new applications. If you have interesting applications that can leverage these machineries, this might be an interesting direction. So there are several open challenges. There are a lot of theoretical questions, not just on geometry. So even in the classical fields, there are still open questions. And for example, we don't know how to deal with time-varying domains, like dynamic networks or dynamic shapes, and other shape representations. This can be a challenge, and computational problems, and so on. Now, test of geography. So this is the beautiful city of
Minnesota.
Right. Rome. So this is Rome, and beautiful city of Rome in the beautiful country of Italy. And there is a beautiful university this year, and soon there will be a beautiful researcher starting a group on geometric and visual computing. And so we will be working on topics like shape analysis, 3D vision, a lot of geometry processing. So if you're interested, please approach me, talk to me. And yeah, thank you. That's it.
A question that came up before. With your experience with this amazing work you have done so far, do you think we really need deep networks or we should look for shallow networks in our case?
So whenever I say deep, I didn't mean so deep. So we have like 5 layers or 7. It's not super deep.
So as came up in Max's talk, we're learning this matrix. In terms of learning the math, we have to learn this matrix. So do we really need so much extra degree of freedom in the network that can come back in requiring more data?
First of all, it depends on what kind of invariance you want to learn. So for example, how deep? So he uses extrinsic networks to shape correspondence. So he has many more degrees of freedom than we have, so he needs like millions of examples. And he needs very deep networks, and he needs 1 month to train the network. So if you want to learn everything, then you need deeper models in general. But
yes and no. Yes and no. The stuff that Howard did, this is with millions of extremely different instances, heavily data augmented.
So this is also a question of your picture.
You can train till the loss stabilizes. Does it mean that it has an overfit?
Absolutely. So that's you're opening a kind of world. So this is a nightmare. So being able to say whether the thing is doing its job and whether we need another layer, that's another question. That's problematic. It's one of the theoretical challenges that I was mentioning.
I have a related question. How many parameters?
Millions, usually. Right?
Millions.
Yes.
What are the pros and cons of using those domains, the three domains you mentioned? The pros and cons. What are the pros and cons of the
pros and cons of?
Yeah, the spatial domain, and the embedding domain.
So I think I gave more or less an idea of what are the pros and cons. Pros and cons of spatial and spectral. you don't have shift invariance. So embedding domain, you have shift invariance. That's the main plus of using embedding domains. Spectral and spatial, it depends on the application. Like spectral works very well if your domain is fixed. So if the shape is not going to be formed, then spectral is the way to go, according to Joan Luna, Jan Legrand, and so on. We, as a group, we use spatial domains for deformable shapes, and we have had a lot of good results.
Any other questions?